So let me first thank the organizers, MSS College Pallam, the Civil Services Club, and its coordinator, Dr. Jolsna, and other organizers of the program for inviting me to share my thoughts about the strategies on preparing civil services examination. And this is, I know very well that this is a very nice afternoon. After a sumptuous lunch, everyone may be in the mood of sleeping, maybe, I don't know. I will try my level best to make you awake, and also I will try to make it short as possible as I can. Maybe after that I can take a couple of questions also. Okay, let me share actually my screen to you. Hope everyone can see the screen right now.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So why candidates are attracted to civil services examination? So maybe you are all of you may be attracted to writing this examination, this prestigious examination. Okay, so I put in some kind of five reasons for attracting to this examination. This is actually, people think that the exam, when you get into this civil services, you'll get power. You can do many things by using that power. This is the only one examination which actually resulted in getting into such kind of powerful post in the country. So which is very, very powerful. And another thing is glamorous, very glamorous post. That's why many people are attending this kind of orientation programs to how to write this examination. Very glamorous to see that, like, you know, we ourselves feel that, you know, when we see someone who is from civil services, we feel very proud and we wanted to be like that and we wanted to be very powerful. Next important thing is very diverse. It's very diverse. So you can work in different fields. So as an IAS officer, you can work not only as a district collector or a secretary, but also you can even go abroad. You can do different departments. One day you may be working in education department, another day in agriculture, and another day in women affairs or whatever. So everything is possible. There will be different departments you can actually work on. Next is, this is very challenging. Everyone, those who are actually looking for a good career, always look for a challenging job. So very challenging job. So challenging opportunities that you wanted to have. So if you don't have challenges in your job, then you may not feel very, very happy. So it's a very, very challenging job. And also people think that you can make changes. A lot of changes you can make in the life of the people. I'm not only saying that the changes for the country, for a system, but also you can make changes in the life of the people. So that's why it is very important, and everyone sees that this exam is very important and this service is very important. And you know very well that 24 posts in civil services examination, they conduct only one exam for this 24 posts, like Indian Administrative Service, Indian Foreign Service, Police Service, like that, many, many, many services, like 24 services till the Pondicherry Police Service Group B. So of course, this first services like Indian Administrative Service, Indian Foreign Service, Police Service, these are all very glamorous posts, and everyone, you can see them. You can see them with you in the society. So you can see that, you know, how they are functioning, how they are working. So that's why everyone wanted to get into either IAS or IFS or IPS, such kind of, you know, posts. So people wanted to be in such kind of services, and there are Group B services also in the list. So all these 24 services, only one examination, which is conducting by UPSC, and qualification. I'm just mentioning you. You may know all these things. Qualification. You need only any degree. You don't need highest qualification like PG or PhD. You need only a degree from a recognized university in the country. Number of attempts. If you are a general candidate, you can attempt 6 times. What do you mean by an attempt? An attempt means when you apply that, you know, when you just apply for the examination, that doesn't even come after applying. If you go for prelims exam, preliminary examination, and sign for the first paper, then your first attempt is gone. So that is how they count this attempt. So general candidates, you will get 6 attempts, and OBC candidates 9 attempts. SCST candidates, there is no limit for attempts. Age limit, minimum 21 years of age you have to attain. Maximum age is 32 years for the general candidates. For SCST candidates is 37 years, and for OBC it is 35 years. So this is how the upper and minimum age limit goes on. Fee, it is very interesting to know that such a powerful examination, such an important examination, you don't have to pay any fees. Girls, you don't have to pay any fees. Boys, you have to pay the fees 100 rupees. That also, for those who are actually having concessions, you don't have to pay. But girls, absolutely, you don't have to pay any fee, 100 rupees only preliminary examination. For main examination, everyone have to pay 200 rupees. That also only after clearing the preliminary examination. Okay. Yeah. There are, as I mentioned, there are 3 parts in this examination. I don't know whether this thing mentioned yesterday's lecture by Ambassador T.P. Srinivasan. So there are 3 parts in the preparation of civil service examination. First is preliminary examination, civil services preliminary examination. You have 2 papers in the preliminary examination, completely objective type examination. So one is actually GS paper and another is CSAT paper too. In the GS paper, I will discuss a little detail later on. GS paper, I will discuss a little later on. Like current events, history, geography, economics, general issues, general science, everything you have to study. Next is, CSAT paper, mostly comprehension skills, interpersonal skills, logical reasoning, and, mental ability, basic numerability, numeracy, data interpretation, such kind of techniques you need to learn for attempting. CSAT paper 2 is only a qualifying nature. You need to get only 33% mark in that. When you get the 33% mark in that second paper only, the other paper will get back. So that is very important. You have to score this 33% mark. Otherwise, the first paper will not get evaluated. So that you have to be very, very careful. I know many candidates who are very good in GS and other things, but they may be a little weak in this mathematics and logical reasoning and all. They may not get into, clearing the prelims examination. So that is very, very important. So even though it needs only 33% to get clear the paper too, but it is very important because that paper you need to clear, then only they will evaluate the paper 1. Okay, this is the prelims examination. Look at the mains examination. I'll tell you a prelims examination a little later. Mains examination. Actually, mains examination is civil services examination. Or the examination for civil services, I would say. This is my opinion. The preliminary examination is for elimination. So the whole lot of candidates are appearing for this examination. About 9 lakhs candidates appear every year for this preliminary examination. So preliminary is very tough because competition is very high. If 1,000 vacancies are there, they will give clearance only for something around 15,000 candidates. 15,000 candidates. So 15,000. So 15,000 candidates only will get clear if there is 1,000 vacancies. So from 9 lakh, after prelims, you have to reach the stage of, or you have to reach the group of 15,000. That is very, very important. And that is the stage, I would say, it's the toughest stage of civil services examination. Mains examination, why I said relatively easier? Because during the mains examination, your competition is only with 15,000 candidates. That's why it is comparatively easier. Not only that, there is another reason for mains. If you commit some kind of mistakes or if you can't perform one of the papers of mains examination, definitely there is an alternative. You can very well come back the next day and then that you can actually match up your foregone marks with this new paper. So that chance is there. There are 9 papers are there. So you have enough freedom to make up your marks even if you cannot perform in one of the papers. But for prelims, it is not the truth. Everything is dependent on one paper, that is General Studies paper 1. So that's why it is very, very important. It is very tough. And also negative marking is also there in the prelims. Negative marking is not there in the mains examination. So number one, you have only less competition, only 15,000 candidates. Number two, you have the chances to make up. Because, you know, if one paper you can't write properly, you can't come back and upgrade your paper with other papers. So in that way, it is relatively easier. So look at what kind of papers are there in the mains examination. Paper one is essay paper, 250 marks. What is this essay paper all about? There will be two sections of questions, four questions each in the essay paper. And you need to answer only one question from the first part and one question from the second part. So like that, you have to answer only two questions from the eight choices in two groups. First group, four questions, second group, four questions. So from first group, one question you have to answer, from second group, one more question you have to answer. Total marks is 250 marks. You have all the time, 3 hours you have, and you can write anything. And the evaluation is based on how you are actually writing or how you are putting your ideas together. This is how they actually evaluate the essay paper. Okay, that is very, very important paper. Second and third paper. Second paper is English for 300 marks. Second paper is languages, that is for 300 marks. Third paper is English, that is also for 300 marks. These two papers, languages means one of the languages, regional languages, you can choose. Any language you can choose. If you are a Malayali, you can choose any language you want. You can choose Tamil, you can choose Urdu, if you are comfortable with. Any language you can choose, and that paper you have to write. That too also, these two papers, this languages paper and English paper, the marks will not get counted into total marks while they consider for, you know, that mains clearance. So that's the one thing that you have to understand. Like in the prelim CSAT paper, here this languages paper, they will not count in the total marks. But at the same time, in the mains examination, the first evaluating paper is the regional language, second is English. So these two papers, you have to get the minimum marks. Minimum marks here, it is roughly, people say it's 50% marks you have to score in this for clearing this paper. So languages means normal Malayalam, like, you know, 8th to 10th standard level Malayalam or Tamil or Urdu or Hindi or whatever. English is also same thing, 8th to 10th English. Like, you know, some kind of grammar or like, you know, precise comprehension or small essay, you know, such kind of things will be there in the English. So these two papers are only qualifying nature. And the paper four is actually general studies paper one, 250 marks. Here in this paper, Indian heritage, culture, history, geography and society, these are included in this paper, 250 marks. Paper four is general studies paper two, that is also 250 marks. Here the governance, constitution, polity, international relations, such things will come here. Paper six, which is actually general studies paper three, which is again 250 marks, and which this paper includes technology, economic development, biodiversity, environment, security, disaster management, and so on and so forth. And paper six, general studies paper four, that is actually also 250 marks. This is actually a very unique paper, which actually includes only the topics related to ethics, integrity, and aptitude. Okay, this is also another important paper. Paper eight and nine are optional papers. You have to choose one option. Before I come to the optional, let me explain a little bit about the general studies. All these papers, like from essay onwards, general studies paper one, two, three, and four, all these papers are written papers, descriptive papers. You have to write it. And most of the time, the questions, if you look, you can see that the questions, they'll say, okay, you just explain this answer in 100 words or 200 words or 300 words, like that. So that means what? You have to have the brevity, and your language has to be very good to express those in the paper. And then at the same time, you have to include all the points, whatever they are asking for. So the choices are there, not many, but choices are there. You can choose. But at the same time, you have to restrict your answers within that specified words limit. Otherwise, you may get penalized as a whole. Like, I'm not saying negative marking, but you may get kind of penalization, because this is also a kind of a personality check. When you write these papers, they will get to know that what kind of person you are. Not only in the personality test that they are checking, but also when you write something in the general studies paper, they know that, you know, how you are writing, how you are organizing your ideas, how you are actually analytically explaining your ideas. That shows your analytical mind, your strength, and your type of personality, which type of personality you are, all those things that they can actually judge through this kind of papers. So coming back to optional subjects, you need to choose one of the optionals. Any optionals you can choose. There is no restriction. If you are an economics person, economics degree you have, you can choose English literature. You can choose even medicine. UPSC never says that, you know, you have to have background knowledge for choosing an optional. So whatever it may be, your degree subject, you can choose any optionals from the list of optionals they have given by UPSC. So then you can choose any optional, and each optional paper has two papers. One is optional paper one, that is 250 marks. Another is optional paper two, that is again 250 marks. So this also you can see, if you go to the website, UPSC website, you can see the syllabus of all these papers. This is the nutshell about, you know, the mains examination. So only 9 papers. In that 9 papers, only 7 papers are actually, they are counting. The other 2 papers are only qualifying nature. You need to score the minimum marks. Only after scoring the minimum marks of those papers, then only they will evaluate the other papers. That you have to keep it in mind. So the grant, the next is interview or personality test. That is actually 275 marks. That I will come back in the next slide. So the grant total marks is for 2025 marks. Mains examination is 2025 marks. Why this is 2025 marks? I'm not including this 600 marks of languages and English. So that we are not including. So the remaining part, including the interview, this grant total is 2025 marks. What is this personality test? You know, after clearing this mains examination, I told you, if the 1,000 vacancies are called for by the UPSC, only 15,000 will get the opportunity to write the mains examination. And after that, only 3,000 candidates, they call 3,000 to 3,500 candidates, they call for interview in Delhi, in UPSC office. Okay, so only 3,000. So, but getting from 15,000 to 3,000 is relatively easier, I would say. So then from 15,000, you are clearing the mains examination, and then you can go for interview. That is about 3,500 candidates. From that, after the interview, they will add this interview max to the total marks, total mains marks. And then, you know, they will publish the results according to the rank they will publish, or they will give you services also. Okay, so what is this personality test? Everyone, every candidate, actually, even before they write the examination, they'll be keep on worrying about what is going to be the personality test or the interview. In the UPSC, they call it as personality test. So interviews for personality test. It is actually roughly around minimum 20 minutes to maybe 1 hour, or sometimes on an average, it will take half an hour to 40 minutes interview, which is actually conducting by 5 members of UPSC board. And UPSC, one of the UPSC board member will be the chairman of the board, and then other 4 subject expert, 3 subject experts and 1 psychologist also will be there. So the 5 people interview. And in the personality test, they are not looking what you are answering. They are not looking that, you know, what kind of answers you are giving, but they are looking how you are answering each question, because your knowledge level already tested through your mains examination. So there is no question about, or no worry, or no confusion about your standard of knowledge or your capacity of knowledge that you have. But they wanted to know what kind of person you are. They cannot ask you like, you know, what kind of person you are. They may ask like that also. Instead, they may ask the questions like, you know, okay, India-China issue is going on right now. What is your take on that? What kind of suggestions would you have been, you know, suggested if you had in that kind of position, or whatever, some kind of situation they'll give, and they'll ask such kind of questions. When you answer such kind of question, they will understand what kind of person you are. So the way you are answering, the way you are arguing, the way you are actually putting your ideas together, the way you are analytically explaining your answers, from that, anyone would understand. As a teacher, I always understand. If a student comes to me and then talk to me 1 hour, I can very well understand, or any teacher would have understood that, you know, understand what kind of person is this. Because, you know, from the talking, we can easily understand whether he or she is genuinely interested, what kind of, you know, intentions he or she is having. Everything you can understand within maybe 1 or 2 hours of discussion, something like that. So these people are very, very experienced. Therefore, they can understand you in half an hour time. So definitely they will actually judge you what kind of person you are from this personality test. That's why they are conducting the personality test. This is what, from here onwards, I wanted to stress more. There are a lot of myths about civil services examination. You would have heard of these myths. Everyone will say, when you say to your parents or your friends or your teachers that I wanted to write civil services examination, first and foremost thing they may be telling you that, oh, civil service examination, you need to know everything under the sun. Nobody in the world, no human being can learn everything under the sun. You cannot learn everything under the sun. And there is not at all necessary for learning everything under the sun for civil services examination. That thing you have to understand. Because, you know, even before understanding that, we may come to a conclusion that, okay, if one needs to know everything under the sun for writing the civil service examination, then I am not eligible. So we will take a position like that. And another thing is what? Only bookies can clear the examination. You know what is bookies like? You know, those people who are actually reading every time, and those who are very voracious readers only can attempt this kind of examination. That is another myth about this civil service examination. And here also you have to understand, we can't read everything under the sun. We can't read everything, every materials, whatever published in the world. You can't read even one subject, all these books that we cannot read. So that we have to understand very clearly. So you just be clear in your mind that, you know, you don't need to read everything under the sun for clearing this examination. Another thing is what? You need a rich background. I won't get, because I am coming from a rural area. I am coming from a poor background. My parents are not working or anything. So therefore, I won't get, I am not eligible for writing this, because we feel ourselves, or we pacify our mind that, okay, I'm not eligible for writing this examination because other people are all coming with a lot of things. I need to spend a lot of money for this, preparing this. I told you how much money you need to spend. Altogether, only 300 rupees you need to spend for writing this examination. So you don't need a rich background. This is a general perception about among the students. Next is what? People say, or teachers will tell you that, you know, you have to be the child of a government official, or you have to be the child of teachers, or you have to be the child or children of civil services officers. Then only you can clear this examination. This is absolutely nonsense. I have heard many things. See, even, you know, I have some experience in writing this examination. That's why I'm categorically telling you that. Many people told me also that, you know, this, you have to, or at least for clearing prelims, you have to have the background. Then only in the interview and all, they will judge based on that. This is absolutely nonsense, and they are not going to judge based on from which background you are coming from. Another thing is personality myth. You need to be well built and, you know, looking very, very good, and then you have to be a very polished personality, or like, you know, your appearance has to be very good. You are people have to say that, oh, wow, this is a good person or something like that. This is not at all. This is really a myth. So don't go after this kind of myths, personality. Another thing is, I told you already, need to read all books and journals. Extra intelligence is needed. Some people say that if you wanted to appear for civil service examination, you need extra intelligence. If you need extra intelligence, UPSC always said they don't need extra intelligent person. They need very practical and very applicational oriented people. Extra intelligence people can go as scientists, or like, you know, as researchers, or as, you know, people who invent things and all. So there is no need of coming to civil services examination. You don't need extra intelligence for preparing this examination. High academic qualification is needed. Some people say high academic qualification, you need at least a PG, otherwise you can't write this examination. So this is also absolutely not true. So you don't need a higher academic qualification for writing this examination, or to get confidence to write this examination. Have to go to Delhi for preparation. That is another thing. If you Google it, you can see that how to prepare for civil services. They'll say that, okay, first you just pack up and go to Delhi and find a place, and then stay there and find a coaching center, and then join there. So this is also not true. There are many people I know, at least for the last 25 years, I know that, you know, many people who actually prepared from Trivandrum or prepared from Cochin or Kozhikode and all, they got into civil services, or like, you know, lower rural areas of Tamil Nadu or Maharashtra or Delhi and all, they sit there, and they, in this world of internet, you don't have to go for, Delhi or anywhere for preparation. Myths are myths. I told you myths are myths. But the fact is, you need to have some qualities for writing this examination. So what are those qualities? You start from today, you keep the passion to write the examination. Whichever class you are, you just keep the passion. I wanted to get into civil services. I wanted to be the officer like the other officer, which we see every day. So I wanted to dictate. I wanted to do some changes for the people of the country. So that passion to write that examination. You feel passionate about writing this examination. That is, then next is dedication. Once the passion comes, automatically the dedication will come. You will feel, you have to explain yourself that why you are writing this examination. So dedicated effort you have to have. So you don't cheat yourself. You have to be very honest, at least to yourself. You just, you know, convince yourself that I am dedicated. I am going to work hard dedicatedly for this examination. Hardworking. Next important thing is hardworking. When I say hardworking, I wanted to explain a little bit what is hardworking. Hardworking, I never mean that, you know, to sit all together right from early morning 3:30 till late night 12:30 and all. You don't need to prepare like that for any examination. Not only for civil service examination, for any examination. You take your own time. You already know that what is a comfortable time that you can prepare for. Olden days, people say that, you know, in early morning, you can, when you read, you will understand better. But nowadays, students or candidates never follow that. They are not comfortable in maybe reading in early morning. I won't say that. So I am not saying hardworking means, you know, extensively reading things. What I meant to say is actually hard work means smart work. You should be able to use your time very wisely. You should be able to plan very wisely. And then you should be able to execute that. And all the things, whatever the you know, that required effort, that you should be able to do it according to your time. So this is what I mean, hard work. Hard work means smart work only. Perseverance, continuously you just persevere for this getting into this examination. Had right kind of direction, you have to have, this is very important, you have to have right kind of direction to get into this examination. Otherwise, you may be preparing many things, but it may not be asking in the question, and it may not be at all relevant for clearing this examination. So that's why I said you have to have right kind of direction. Then only you can clear this examination. Next important thing is you have to have right kind of materials. When you know, in this internet world, when you go to web, you can see that when you Google it, you can get millions and millions of sheets of materials which will say that it is for civil services preparation. How much you can read? How do you know that which one is good for you? This is why you need direction, proper direction. So right kind of materials you have to select. Then only what? You can actually prepare very, very effectively. Otherwise, you may be collecting something and you may be reading in the net, lot of bogus things also will come. So we cannot depend on such kind of material. So you have to be very, very clear about what kind of materials that you are using. Can spend quality time for preparation. If you can spend quality time for preparation, then you can attempt for this examination. So you have to spend some time for preparing this examination. This is not that very easily you can prepare. The common references, like, you know, I always say this, reading newspapers. Yesterday, TPs are also would have told you this thing. So reading newspaper is very, very important. I will tell you why this is important from the perspective of this examination in the next slide or so. Because, you know, I categorized into different type of questions, you know, how much mark, which is actually coming from various areas and also. Then you will understand the importance of reading the newspapers. Reading newspaper is very, very important. Notes preparation is other important thing. You have to prepare your own notes all the time. Why notes preparation? People ask me that, you know, can't I purchase notes or borrow notes from others? There are many notes are available, like, you know, first rank holders notes, second hand holders notes, or some agencies notes. These are all notes very good. But I never advocate to borrow or buy the note from others. You just prepare each and every candidate who are very, very seriously trying to attempt this examination. Please prepare your own notes. You have to prepare your own notes. Why I would say that? Why I saying that? Because, notes is something different thing. Notes is your own unique thing. You are actually preparing notes based on your strength and weaknesses. You cannot actually read others' notes, because other person in a lecture hall, while a teacher is teaching, maybe 50 students are sitting. So the understanding level of all those 50 students are different. Therefore, each and every student, they write their notes according to their strength and weaknesses only. So you cannot actually exchange the notes and notes and read. That's why I always say teachers should never give notes in the class, because when we give notes, we are giving notes based on our strength or our weaknesses. That may not be the strength or the weaknesses of the students. So at least in civil services examination, definitely the people, the candidates has to understand their strength and their weaknesses for preparing this examination. And then accordingly, you have to prepare your own notes. That's why your notes is unique and your notes only can be used for future or references for your examination. Next is you have to by heart or learn some kind of memory techniques, because a lot of things you have to by heart, like, you know, formulas, like science concepts, economics concepts, or like dates from the history, or the place names from geography, or something like, you know, articles of the constitution and other kinds of things. So these kind of things we will never actually remember. Any person, any human being can't actually what remember all these details, all these small things. So that you need some kind of memory techniques you have to by heart. There are a lot of techniques. I'm not discussing all those things here. There are a lot of techniques that you can remember your statistics or your dates or your place names or the articles of the constitution and things like that. So that techniques you have to learn. And next is about basics about subjects. All the subjects. This is a one examination. You need to understand the basics about almost all the subjects. See, the here is the problem for preparing civil service examination. Why? Because maybe you are from a humanities background or a science background. Those who are from humanities background, they are very poor in science, reading and understanding science and science part, because they are not exposed to. They may be studied only up to 10th or 12th standard. So after that, they would have forgotten all those things. So it is very important to learn such kind of basic, basic subjects from all the subjects. So for that, NCERT books are very good. I would say you should start reading from 7th to 12th. So don't hesitate and don't feel shy to read the textbooks, NCERT books from 7th. I said NCERT. I'm not saying, any other CBSE or other kinds of books or anything. I said NCERT because NCERT books actually prepared by a group of eminent people, eminent scholars who are related to that particular subjects. So you can see that when you go to NCERT, any standard book, you can see the who wrote that. Say, for example, history, modern Indian history book of 12th standard, written by Bipin Chandra, none other than Bipin Chandra. Bipin Chandra is the most famous modern Indian historian in this country. So like that, any NCERT books you take, such kind of people are writing. Therefore, that will give you very, very, very in-depth knowledge about those subjects. Once you finish reading this, then you will feel very confident and you will recollect what you have learned in your 7th to 12th standard. And then, that will give some kind of pump up, some kind of boosting. And then you can actually systematically prepare. From there onwards, you can systematically prepare the other subjects. So that's why I said basics, you have to be very, very thorough about. And journal reading, some journals you have to read, that I'll tell you what are the journals that you need to read for this examination. Important general books are there that actually you have to take and you have to keep it. Next is choosing optional. You have to choose the optional. There are techniques to choose the optional. You cannot actually choose any optional, because many a time, if I ask an MA English student, what optional you are going to choose, then definitely 90% of the students will say that I'll choose maybe geography or maybe some kind of sociology or something. Then I would ask, promptly I'll ask that question, why you are not choosing your English optional, because you already learned for 5 years BAMA, why you are not choosing? She or he will say that, I'm not very comfortable because it's very, very depth and very intensive. Why they are saying like that? Because those who are learning the subject, they know that how depth it is. But those who are not learning the subject, they don't know how depth it is. That's why when you choose the optional, don't choose that. The optional is very easy. There is no optional like that. It is very easy. Every optional has its own actually toughness. Every optional has its own, strength. So therefore, don't think that Malayalam optional is very easy, or literature optional is very easy, or sociology is very easy, or engineering subject is very tough, mathematics is very tough and all. Don't take such kind of judgmental positions. You just understand the question syllabus. There is a technique like to choose the optional question. You have to understand the question. You have to understand the syllabus. And then you have to discuss with the people who are actually experienced such kind of things. And then, you know, you come and choose the optional. So either for the examination, the technique is you have to know something about everything and everything about something. This is how we explain about this examination. You need to know something about everything. See, I am talking right now to a computer. Then how this is actually transmitting to you, and then you are listening, you are seeing me. What is the physics behind that? Or what is the science behind that? What are the techniques that it is actually, what are the methodologies they are using? This kind of things, actually, you have to learn. This is what I said. Basic things that you need to learn. Then only something about every subject you need to learn. Then and certain subjects, certain areas, you need to know everything. So that also you have to identify. While you prepare for this examination, when it goes on, when you get some kind of exposure and experience, you will yourself will be able to understand that which are the topics that I would actually prepare as general and which are the other topics that I would actually prepare in depth. So then, you know, that moment I would say you are ready to write the examination. Look at here, prelims, general studies, marks distribution, subject wise. Many people actually ask this question. You can see that from 2016 to 2019, how much marks, percentage of marks in the prelims examination. You can see the importance of current affairs. Current affairs is a major area for civil services examination. That's why everyone says, read newspaper. Look at the current affairs question, percentage of marks, 25 to 30% of marks every year, exclusively they'll ask from current affairs. Then next important thing is actually what? Science and history. These are also very important. So 15 to 20% questions or marks, they ask from this kind of, they earmark to these kind of subjects. So these areas you have to be Indian economy, polity, equally something like, you know, 10 to 15 or 16% of marks from those areas. Geography, another area, 15% will come. So this is how actually distribution of marks comes. So negative marking is there for the prelims. Negative marking is actually about the 0.66 marks because it's one third, it's out of 200 marks. Prelims is 200 marks. Therefore, you will lose 0.66 marks from, excuse me, from where you scored. Negative marking, the problem is what? So when you commit a mistake in a question, your negative marks will be actually taken away from the marks you have scored. This is a very important issue. Okay, so penalty is only for wrong answers. If you are not answering a question, you won't get any penalty. You can leave it blank. But if you attempt a question and if it goes wrong, then you will get penalty marks of 0.66. And look at how much mark you need to get the prelims examination. That is how, you need to get only very limited marks. Look at this, general candidates out of 200, roughly around 98 to 100 marks you have to get. What does that mean? That means in the prelims question paper, 100 questions are there. Out of that, only 50 questions you need to get correct. Then, you know, you can clear the prelims. That's what the studies say. Various experiences of the candidates say. So out of 200, you need to get 98 marks means what? You need to get right answers for 49 questions. So 49 questions, if it get right and none of the questions goes wrong, then you will get 98 marks. Here, important problem is what? Many people will get this 98 or 100 or 120. But then when it counted, you won't get 98 or 90 or 70 because you most of the question, a lot of the question, you would have committed mistake and then negative mark will attract. So that is how you are not getting. So the ideal marks, everyone say that, the ideal marks, so for without any problem that you can say that you will definitely clear, that kind of mark is something between 120 to 130 marks. That means you have to answer correctly 60 to 65 questions. If your 60 to 65 questions are correct and none of the questions goes wrong, then you are clearing the prelims examination. Why I am saying this? Because in the prelims examination, even though 100 questions are there, to getting 65 exclusively right itself is very, very tough. That's what I am saying. So why it is tough? Because it is not tough actually. There is a particular kind of preparation you need to clear the prelims examination. I'm saying this is actually the toughest part of this examination is preliminary examination. So you have to be very, very careful about that. That is primarily because of the competition and because of this negative marking. Okay. And this is the syllabus. When you see the syllabus, everyone will wonder that, okay, this is the only syllabus that it has. That's why this guy is saying that, you know, this is the toughest examination. Look at the syllabus. Just like what? Seven lines are there. Just seven lines. This is a preliminary examination syllabus, preliminary civil services preliminary examination syllabus. Civil syllabus apparently looks very simple, but importance of making a strong base for answering this is very, very important. You take any question, you can easily freely download the questions from the UPSC website, previous questions. So you can see that what kind of questions they are asking, whether you can answer it or not. Today itself, you just download the last year's question. You just see, it's free. You just see through that. Just read. Then you can understand. And it is very interesting to note that most of the questions, maybe just a general, just a person who are finishing the reading of the NCERT books, they will feel that 70-75% of questions they know. But at the same time, when you look at the answers, they will get confused. They'll perplexed. So which answer that I'll give? First one or second one or something like that. So this is a problem. So when you don't have clarity, the problem is you will get confused between options. So when you get confusion between options, you will end up in writing either right or wrong. If you get right only, the mark will get added. If you get wrong, what will happen? You will get negative mark and it will be a problem. So that's why it is very important. Even though syllabus looks very easy, it is not that easy to prepare that examination. Why civil services preparation is unique? This is very important. Another very important thing. Only examination in the world which needs 1.5 years of preparation. This examination needs 1.5 years of preparation. Why I said this? Because normally this time the prelims examination postponed. But normally this preliminary examination they conduct in June and the mains examination in October, November, and the interview may be coming in the next April, May, and the result will come only in the May end and all. So you need a preparation not from June. You have to start from this year's, they would have started the preparation from this year's January, and then it will continue up to the next April. So that's what I said, 1.5 years of preparation you need for this examination. Keeping the morale throughout this period is the toughest task. I always say this, you know, it is not the toughest one to read and learn the things, but the toughest part is what? Keep your morale high throughout this period. This 1.5 years period is a very quite long time. Then during this long time, many things can happen in your life. Many things, many ups and downs can happen in your life. So the result is what? Depending upon the ups and downs, your preparation, your morale and your feeling, everything also will get affected. So then many a time you will feel that, you know, I'm not preparing anymore. I wanted to get a job immediately and I'll get into something and then I'll go. And sometimes for the girls or something, parents may pressure for marriage or such kind of things or getting job and all. And some other people, so society, always the society is actually under watch. Like, you know, they will be watching you and then they will be forcing you that, you know, why you are preparing this long and then why can't you try for some other course? Why can't you try for something else? So this kind of like, you know, lot of confusions will come in between this throughout this 1.5 years of time. So then that keeping that morale throughout the period is very toughest task. That's why I always say that preparing civil services examination is not your own preparation, but the preparation is a kind of a combined and team effort of your own, your family, your teachers, and your society. So there is 3-stage examination, 2 years of training. So you have 3-stage examination, like I said, preliminary, mains, and interview. After that, once you clear the examination, there are 2 years of examination. If you get into IAS or IPS or any group one services, first training 3 months, you will be 6 months of training will be there in Missouri Academy, Uttaranjal. And after that, you know, respective academies like, you know, police training will be in Hyderabad, revenue service training will be in Mumbai, and such kind of training academies, foreign trade will be there in Indian Institute of Foreign Trade, Delhi. Like that, many, many academies are there. After that, you will be getting field training like assistant collector and all. And during that time, you have to, if it is IAS, you have to work as a village officer or tahsildar or as a section officer, everything you have to do. Then after that, again, you will go back to Missouri Academy, and then again, you will have wrap up three months, 3 months training, plus you have to get clear a lot of examination also. So your examination is not finishing by the interview. Your examination will continue throughout. During the entire training period, you will actually have to face many examinations. You have to keep your scores very high also. So that is also there. And prelims is the toughest part, I said. You need all the cooperation, need proper guidance. I always say proper guidance means it is kind of like, marathon running. It is a kind of a marathon running. So you are starting the running. If you don't know how to run, where that you need to run and all, then what will happen? You will not finish the finishing point. You may be running throughout the areas, and then you don't know where to run. So that's why you need a proper guidance for clearing this examination. Need to be very clear about your approach, your strategy and methods of preparing this examination. So then what is approach? What is strategy? What are the methods that you would adopt for preparing this examination? Look at this. What do you mean by civil services approach? Approach means what? Approaching this examination means set the correlative exception assumptions right. So that examination approach, study approach, your personal philosophy, everything, you have to fine tune to the requirements of civil services examination. So this is very, very important. Study approach means examination approach. Of course, we know that we are going to see that, it's very important examination. So I need to get, I have dedication. So definitely I am going to aim for this civil services. Next is study approach means, are you going to study yourself, or you are going to depend on any other institution or web or whatever? So that kind of things you have to be very, very, very clear. Then only you can actually make your strategies. Next is personal philosophy. So are you going to compromise many, many things for this examination or not? You have to take a decision, because otherwise don't get into this examination. I told you, you are going to waste your 1.5 years of time, long time. So whether you can compromise your short-term happinesses or the long-term dreams or not. If you can't do that, please don't venture into this. So personal promises, personal philosophy, you have to change certain philosophies. You may be a very outgoing person. You may be a traveler. You may be roaming around and things like that. Okay, you can do to a certain extent, but at the same time, your personal life and your personal philosophy has to fine-tune to the requirements of this examination. Next is strategy. Once your approach is very clear, then you make your strategy. What is your strategy? Planning for setting that approaches or goals and all. That I divide that strategy into two: resources strategy and time strategy. What is resources strategy? Materials and money. What do you mean by material? Material means the that studied materials, learning materials. What kind of materials that you are going to use? From where you are going to get these materials for study? Which kind of books that you are going to read? And what kind of resources? How much money you need for acquiring these things? Whether I need any money at all or not? Are these resources are available free or not? Whether any teachers are available nearby, or whether I can go and stay some other place and study. So these kind of strategy that you have to be very clear. Next is what? Next is time strategy. Optimizing time, the most scarce resource. Like, time is the most important thing. You don't have much time to complete all these kind of topics and materials. So therefore, you have to prepare that. That itself is a separate lecture. So I'm not going to venture into that. So time strategy is very, very important. How to manage your time. What kind of time is? Everyone is having same time only. But managing the time depends on their own family background, their own personal life. All kinds of things will influence this time strategy. So here also, your time strategy will not be suitable for other person's time strategy, because you may be waking up early morning, you may be sleeping very late. That are all your own personal thing. So depending upon that, you can make your time strategy. You cannot make your timetable based on the other person's background. So that's why this is another important strategy. Once the strategy is clear, you have to make your method for executing it. So first, your approach, you have to be very, very clear. Then your strategy of preparing this examination have to be very clear. Then the methods, what kind of methods you are going to use, like, timetable or memory techniques, note preparation methods, practice test methods, time management during examination, how you are going to do all these small important things. You just foresee all things based on your teachers or your institution that you are studying for civil services, or your experienced in the, you know, the previous people, or depending upon, or like discussing with all kinds of people. You just prepare these methods, and then, you know, you be clear about executing those methods. Then you can be very confidently, you know, appear for this examination. You know, why the people are having doubt in between? Because they are not clear about their approach. They're not clear about your strategy. They're not clear about their methods. So that's why they are actually in between, worrying about what do I do? How do I go forward? So this kind of clarity, if you bring in, then, you know, you can actually easily prepare for this examination. Little bit explanation about strategy, which is very important. Your strategy is your own. Your strategy is not anybody else's strategy. You can only make your own strategy. Your strengths are your own. Your weaknesses are your own. Your knots are your own. Your timetable is your own. Your preparation is your own, unique. So it is, see, don't compare with others. You are unique and you are yourself. Don't compare. Please don't compare yourself with others. You may be seeing some other person in the class also. When you sit, some other student may be, you know, understanding, interacting with the faculty, and then maybe scoring more marks than you, and all. You will start comparing with her or him. So that is not a good idea. You can, healthy competition you can have, but don't compare the entire life of yours with other person. So you are a unique person. Don't rush and get into civil services. Don't rush in preparing also. Be slow and steady and win the race. Please understand that, you know, UPSC always wants general studies. They are looking for general studies. They never say general knowledge for their examination. This is a very important distinction. Why? Because general knowledge is different from general studies. General knowledge is something like, you know, for example, who is you know, the president of China, or who is actually the which river is actually going through that region, which is actually having the problem between India and China. So these are all general knowledge. But general studies means you should be able to understand the in depth, the details about you know, this India China relations. Then you are actually preparing for general studies. I'll finish it soon. What is the success mantra for winners? Hard work and consistency. Never give up attitude. Focus. Winners means winners of civil services. Focus and determination. Clarity about approach, strategy and methods. Meticulous planning and deliverance. Not only planning, many people plan, but deliverance is also important. You have to deliver it, not any time, but the apt time you should be able to deliver it. Self-confidence, time management, practical, be practical about things. Don't be into the fantasy world all the time. Be practical, positive thinking, and dream big. And then today itself, you just dream that I'm going to get into civil services. I'll become this IAS officer in this district or in the state. Then, you know, you will feel some kind of what? Inner strength. So from that strength, you can actually prepare for this examination. This is actually some kind of references. I can share with you maybe later on. Reference book subject wise. So I just compile this reference books for you. Like, you know, these reference books minimum, those who are starting the civil services preparation, you just check that whether you have read all these books. I would say definitely 100%, at least minimum, all these references you have to read. These references you can read it in next 3 months time. So you just take it down and then prepare the buy, or like all these NCRTs you can download free from the website. Okay, little bit more about the personality test. They will not check, I told you, they will not check your knowledge. What are they checking? They are checking three things: outlook, attitude, and aptitude. What is outlook? Outlook is what you visualize. What is attitude? The attitude that you express. What is the aptitude? What is the aptitude is that you possess. Attitude and aptitude are entirely different. Sometimes you can see the attitude of a person, but we don't know that what the kind of aptitude he has. He is having. Definitely the aptitude influences the attitude of a person. So these things they will check. They evaluate to various questions. What is your outlook about the country, about the people, about the society, about yourself? You should first have to have outlook about yourself. Your attitude, you about yourself, aptitude about yourself. First, you just have all these things yourself. Then you just look at the world and criticize or give opinion about other people or the society. So this is what they test in the civil services interview. So all human beings are born with strengths and weaknesses. Enhance your self-confidence. If you are not believing in yourself, then no one is there to believe you. No one is going to believe you. So this is the one thing, especially from the students from Kerala, they're lacking the self-confidence. Even myself, I was not having that kind of confidence maybe some 10, 15 years back and all. So I gained that because of from my experience. So you cannot wait that many days, that many years right now. So be self-confident. So you start believing yourself first. Then, you know, others will also believe in you. Some quotes from our former chancellor: without your involvement, you can't succeed. With your involvement, you can't fail at all. So your involvement is very important. And also, don't compare your life to others. There is no comparison between sun and moon. They shine when it's their time. So you will try to compare. We are all comparing ourselves with other person. So they are like that, they are like this, they achieved that, they achieved this. But it is like comparing sun and moon. Both will shine. Moon is also shining in the daytime. But why it is not shining? Because it's the sun's time. So when moon's time in the night comes, it will shine. Sun is not there. So believe like that. Okay? And then don't upset about your failure in your first attempt. Because even the successful maths start with zero. So don't be afraid about, I'm minding a minor. So there are a lot of questions also coming now. Okay, last slide. If you want to shine, you know, burn like a sun. Everyone wants to shine like a sun, but first burn like a sun. So where there is a will, there is a way. All the very best. So just at least you just attempt this examination. Don't get shy away from this examination. Well, there is nothing to lose. Just attempt that. Everyone can attempt. So where there is a will, there is a way. Thank you very much.